Right here. The word of the Lord to us here tonight. In the New King James, it says, forsake foolishness, I think. Yeah, forsake foolishness and live. And go in the way of understanding. We're going to talk about that way a little bit. We've been talking about that way through the whole book of Proverbs so far. The way of wisdom, the way of sanctification, the way of following the Spirit. Father, I yield to you. I just yield to you. These people are not here to hear from me. They're here to hear from you. Let us get out of your way. I pray for your inspiration. I pray through the intuitive leading of the Holy Spirit, Lord. And may we be encouraged by your presence. May we be blessed by your leadership and by your teaching. We yield to you now in Jesus' name. Open our hearts to you. Ask that you minister to us, Lord, from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. The writer of Hebrews says that in the old days, God spoke to us in various ways, at various times, through various means, through the prophets, through their writings. What we've been looking at in Proverbs here, the book of Proverbs, the book of Job, the book of Psalms, the book of Songs of Solomon, these are all Hebrew poetry. I would suggest to you that God is speaking to us through this book, through this Hebrew poetry, in one of those various ways. Now, in Hebrew poetry is a little different from English poetry. English poetry uses rhyme and rhythm and meter and these musical qualities. Hebrew poetry, that's hard to say, uses lines of thought, spiritual principles, godly wisdom, and things like this. But the part that's the same about English poetry as Hebrew poetry, got it right that time, is that there are characters that are cast that are representative of someone or something greater. We're going to see several, as we move through the chapters, contrasts between the woman wisdom. Okay, Bible students, who does she represent? No, the woman wisdom. She represents whom? Holy Spirit, Ema, Mama. In the family of God, we're not talking about sexual identity or gender. We're talking about a role, a characteristic. Mama, the teacher, Holy Spirit. God is one, the Spirit. He manifested himself into human flesh, the person Jesus Christ. Okay, Jesus sacrificed that body, sowed that seed. It brought up a harvest in the resurrection so that the Holy Spirit, we saw the Spirit of God in Jesus. We saw the attitude of God in Jesus, an attitude of grace and kindness and compassion, that our daddy was willing to sacrifice himself for us, pay the penalty we couldn't pay. We saw that in Jesus. Jesus said, "Believe in me, and I'll send you the Holy Spirit to dwell in us, to lead us, to guide us, to empower us to be able to relate to God." Okay? All right? I would suggest to you that this woman wisdom that's cast in this character role of the woman wisdom, that she's representative of that Spirit. Matter of fact, she told us a chapter or so ago that she was with God in the beginning, before the foundations of the world, creating, that the intelligence and the wisdom and the understanding and the knowledge that he used to imagine and create all creation and speak these things into existence is what she's offering us. Now, she's contrast with the woman folly or foolishness or the immoral woman or the adulteress or what I call the whore. She represents Babylon. She represents Antichrist. She represents the world system that's trying to lead us astray. Now, there's an offer on the table right here in the beginning of this chapter. We're going to go through that a little bit because Mama, Ema, the Holy Spirit, the woman wisdom, Jesus, God, is offering us something. It's going to be contrasted with the offer of the woman foolishness. Okay, so I'm setting the stage up. That's what my intentions are, is to point this out. So let's look through this, some of this stuff. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 1. Wisdom, it's a feminine noun. It's describing the person. We talked about that there. Wisdom in Proverbs is a person. It's the Holy Spirit. It's a process. It's where we learn to use information and our intelligence that we're building in order to build understanding. We're going to look at what understanding is in a minute. And it is also the intelligence skill that we develop in our minds and in our hearts to use the information that we gather up in the world today for the benefit of the body of Christ, as opposed to the way we always did it, Steve. We'll use that for the glory of ourselves. Use that to gratify ourselves, gratify our flesh, that kind of thing. So we're learning a different way. We're developing a different attitude. Okay, so let's look and see. So wisdom, the person, the Holy Spirit, Ema, Mama, she's built her house. She's built her family abode, is what that word. But you've heard about the house of Jacob or the house of Abraham, or right? That's what we're talking about. You might even bring this into... I'm going to say it. I'm going to go out on the proverbial limb here. If it breaks off and drops me and I break my neck, okay. She's built her ark. Her ark. Everybody with me? You know, the ark was a picture of Jesus. God invited all those who were willing to believe into the ark to be spared from the judgment. He closed the door. We were safe. That's what she's offering us here. She's offering us a place in her family, in her abode. Okay? So wisdom, she's built her house. She has hewn out the seven pillars. Okay? So her family, the sanctuary of the Holy Spirit, is built upon seven pillars. Now, if you look and do some research, the seven pillars of they call it the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit are as such: wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude, knowledge, piety, and fear of the Lord. I feel like that the tradition has inserted piety in the place of faithfulness or righteousness. But how do we gain righteousness? The example was there for us with Abraham. How did he get credited righteousness? He believed God, and he was faithful to that belief. That's the message for the church. Do you believe God? Are you willing to be faithful? In the Greek, the faith and faithfulness are the same Greek word. It's pistis. They're interchangeable. And so if you're a person of faith, it should be visible in your faithfulness. Now, are we talking about just church? Are we talking about just Bible reading? Are we talking about just prayer? No, we're talking about all of it. Faithful to my job. Faithful to my friends. Faithful to my family. Faithful to serve the bride of Christ that I belong to. You with me? We saw... See, I started getting hot. Mama nose started running. I told you it was going to do it. We saw back over here in chapter 8, wisdom dwell with prudence, okay? And I find out knowledge and discretion. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, so there's the fear of the Lord. We saw knowledge already. Counsel in verse 14, counsel is mine. Sound wisdom, I am understanding. I have strength, that's fortitude. You see what I'm saying? It's all there. We can go over to Isaiah chapter 11, and we can start looking at it. It says, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. We're talking about Jesus. The Spirit of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and might, or fortitude, knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. That's six of the seven. But look down here a little further in verse 5 of chapter 11, Isaiah, and it says that righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. These are the pillars upon which this family is built. This is the offer, okay? The family, the ark, the house, the home, the abode of the Holy Spirit of wisdom, as she's built her house, that house is, that family is built upon these seven pillars. She's slaughtered her meat, she's mixed her wine. She's also furnished her table. So she set the table. We're being invited into the family with a seat at the table, with the provision of the meat and the wine, which represents joy. She's also furnished the table. Jesus said, in my Father's house, there's plenty of room. Come on to the table, sit down and be part of the family. You see, church tradition, especially in the Bible Belt right here, has tried to teach us for years and years and years that this was about religion. We need to be pious. You know, there's a difference in pious and piety. You know that piety is unresistant, maybe? That's not the word that was used. Reverence for God. Pious is more about performance and duty. See, the Pharisees, they were pious. They looked good on the outside. It looked good. That's not what we're being invited into. We're being invited to a table, to where mama has set it with everything that we need. Peter said that his divine power has provided everything that we need for life and godliness. Place at the table. Family. Praise the Lord. You can say it out loud if you want to. So it speaks of provision. There's provision been made for the family. The meat's there, the wine's there, the joy's there, the table's furnished. Okay, so she sent out an invitation. Verse 3, she sent out her maidens, that's her servants. She cries out from the highest places of the city. Whoever is simple, that's naive. Whoever is easily led astray. Whoever is not, does not have understanding. We're going to look at that in a minute. I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag yet. But anyway, whoever's naive, who's simple, who's easily led astray, whoever is just led astray by any old voice in the world, let him turn in here and sit down at the table. I don't know about you, but when I got here, I was pretty simple. I needed a place at the table. I needed wisdom and understanding, and I needed counsel, and I needed fortitude and strength in the midst of adversity. I needed knowledge. I needed the fear of the Lord. I needed everything that was offered to me. Whoever's simple, let him turn in here. And it is for him who lacks understanding, she says to him, come and eat of my bread. That's provision. Bread always speaks of provision in the Bible typology. And drink of the wine I have mixed. That's joy. Wine represents joy in Bible typology. It also speaks of communion. We have communion here every Sunday morning. We take of the bread. We remember the Lord's sacrifice. Take of the bread. Take of the cup. And remember what the Lord has done for us, because we're nothing and nobody without Him. That's what this is speaking of. Abraham ran into this way back in Genesis 14, I think, when he ran into Melchizedek. He had just taken 316 farmhands and defeated the king of Sodom and another king, wiped them out, plundered the thing, brought it all back, ran into Melchizedek. Melchizedek had bread and wine set at the table. Melchizedek was an Old Testament appearance of Jesus Christ before the incarnation. He brought the bread and wine. Wisdom, the Holy Spirit, Ema, she says, come sit at my table. I've got everything you need. I want to provide the wine and the bread for you. I want you to take part in my table. Take part in my family. And she says this, forsake foolishness and live and go in the way of understanding. Now, I'll let the cat out of the bag. Let's jump over to verse 10. And it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Walk in the way of understanding, in the way of the knowledge of the Holy One. Who's the Holy One? Say it out loud. Speak up like you got a pair. You remember when Jesus ran into the guy that was possessed by the 2,000 or whatever it was, demons and legion, and it was his name and everything. And he said, he's walking up to him and he said, whoa, 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 wait a minute. I know who you are. You're the Holy One of God. What do you want with us? The Holy One, knowledge of the Holy One, an intimate knowledge of the Holy One. That's understanding. Remember me telling you all through this study so far, maybe I was ignorant, didn't even know that it was going to come out this way, but understanding was the goal of the skill and the person and the process of wisdom. The understanding was the goal. It's knowledge of the Holy One. Everything that we need is tied up, sewed up, wrapped up in a package and set on the table and provided for us in Jesus. I used to hear things like this and I'd go, because we're hostile in our nature. My pastor coached me and said, hey, man, come on, you don't think too much about that stuff. Just deny that stuff because it's just nature. It's our character. It's our nature apart from God. It's hostile. It doesn't want you to have salvation. It doesn't want you to have freedom. It doesn't want you to have redemption. It doesn't want you to make it to heaven. It doesn't want you to know God. Our carnal nature. Don't worry about that. Deny that. Sit down and shut up. That's what I say to that other spirit that's in conflict with the Spirit of the Lord. Sit down, shut up. Forsake foolishness and live. Remember what I said, the logos, the word of God that became flesh. What was that declaration, that logos? What was that? Live! Ezekiel said it. God said it through the prophet Ezekiel. I saw you struggling in your own blood, and I said to you, live! Forsake foolishness. You might say forsake folly. Keep that in your back pocket for when we get over here. Forsake that. Forsake that nature that's hostile to God. And live. And go in the way of understanding in the knowledge of the Holy One. Verse 7, he who corrects a scoffer gets shame for himself. And he who rebukes a wicked man only harms himself. Don't correct a scoffer or he'll hate you. Rebuke a wise man and he'll love you. What he's talking about, here's what Jesus said to the apostles over there when he said, don't throw your pearls to pigs. They'll just trample them in the mud, turn around and cut you to pieces. Don't bother with that. Don't mess with that. You see a wise man, you see a man of understanding, you see a man who is a believer or whatever, you got a word of encouragement for him, encourage him. Now, I'm not saying that we don't need to proclaim the gospel message. We need to proclaim the gospel message. But if you think you're going to correct a scoffer, you're fooling yourself because he'll just scoff. That's what they do. Jesus even said it later on somewhere back here. I don't remember where it is. He gave me this much, but not all of it. But he said, let the scoffers scoff and the mockers mock. And don't worry about that stuff. Shake the dust off your feet and move on. That's what he's saying here. Rebuke a wise man and he'll love you. You straighten a wise man out. He'll love you. Give instruction, verse 9. Give instruction to a wise man, and he'll be wiser still. Teach a just man. That's a man who has given weight and value to understanding, to the knowledge of the Holy One, and he'll increase in learning. Verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now, the fear of the Lord, we're not talking about quaking in fear and falling down. Now, if the Lord were to manifest himself right here, his glory would cause us to fall flat of our face and tremble in fear. But that's not what he wants of us. Every time we saw anybody in the Old Testament encounter the angel of the Lord, and they fell flat of their face like a dead man. John said he did it when he came into the presence of the angel. I fell on my face like a dead man. What'd the angel say? Don't fear. Get up. He said it time and time and time again. Don't fear. Get up. For by me, your days will be multiplied. Stephen, we were just talking about that. For by me your days will be multiplied, and your years of your life will be added to you. If you're wise, you're wise for yourself. And if you scoff, you'll bear it alone. You're responsible for the choices that you make in life. If you seeking to be wise, you'll be wise to yourself. It'll be beneficial to you. It'll also be beneficial to other people. But if you decide you want to be a mocker and a scoffer and go in the way of foolishness, you'll bear it alone. I'm the only mocker, scoffer, way of foolishness person here to testify that you'll bear it alone. Excuse me. When I get hot, here we go. I walked in the way of foolishness for 52 years of my life. Sometimes I still do. Sometimes I still can get a little self-centered, a little aggravated at the people around me, you know, because they're all stupid, not like me. I'm not going to require it of you, but I should get a witness right there. I'm out here on the road, and I'm like, oh, yeah, well, grumble, grumble, growl, gripe, park in the fuel aisle and go in and get your food. People disrespectful, blah, blah, blah. We're right back on to the scoffers again. Don't worry about them people. I'm blessed. Walking in the peace and the understanding and the wisdom of the Lord. Why am I worried about them people? Because I've still got this old carnal guy inside of me that thinks that he ought to get his way. Because the struggle is real. The battle between the hostile carnal nature that's a part of every one of us as long as we're wearing this earth suit and the Holy Spirit of God that's trying to lead us in the way of understanding, there's a struggle. There's a hostility that needs to be acknowledged if we're going to get better. But she's offering us a place in her family, in the ark, in the protected sanctuary, in Jesus. She's offering us a place at the table that will provide for everything that we need for life and godliness. And it will be with joy. We see two references to the wine. The wine represents joy. She's not expecting us to be a bunch of old swelled up sticks in the mud who approves. She's expecting us to be joyful and enjoy our salvation and walk with the Lord with our head held high. I don't care what the past is. Praise the Lord. She's inviting us into the family of God with redemption, and heaven is our goal. It's for you to choose. Because if you're wise, you're wise for yourself. Other people will benefit from that. But if you scoff, I don't know, let's do that Jesus mess. You'll bear it alone. Now, this is the invitation from the Holy Spirit, from wisdom, from Ema, from Mama. I want you to walk away from here tonight knowing full well and squaring it away and settling in your mind that there's not three persons that make up one God. There's one God who manifested himself in three persons. that this is Jesus, that this is God the Father, that they are one, that the same Spirit that created everything that we see that testifies to the glory of God every day, that's who's speaking to us. That's whose table we're being invited to sit at. That's whose wisdom, intelligence, and skill, and knowledge, and creativity that is being in offered to us to partake of. Now, that's a choice. If you choose Jesus, you can walk in the way, in the process of wisdom, and find and wind up in the understanding, the knowledge of the Holy One. But if you don't choose that, or if you reject that, it doesn't matter if you say, no, thank you, and you do it real politely. It's still rejection. Jesus is offering us life, and life abundantly, with peace and joy, and knowing that we're reconciled to our Creator, and there's no hostility between, that God is at peace with us and we're at peace with God, that we can walk through this life knowing that we're okay with our Creator. That's what's being offered to us. But if we reject it, then by default, we're handing over the leadership of our lives to her. Verse 13. A foolish woman. Her name is Folly in this Hebrew poetry. She's representative of the greater threat, the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world. You might call him Antichrist. You might call him the devil. You might call him Satan. You call him anything you want. It's the same character. This foolish woman, she's clamorous, means she's a noisy and always raising a ruckus. She's a drama queen. Anybody know people that just can't bear to walk a day or a step through life without some drama? Stirring up stuff all the time. She's clamorous. See, our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's against powers and principalities and wicked things in high places. She has been cast in the role of this Hebrew poetry as the woman Folly. She's representative of the greater threat. She's clamorous. She's a drama queen. She's noisy. She's simple. That word simple, the Hebrew word, it means irresponsible and stupid. That's not much gray area in that, right? Irresponsible and stupid. That word simple is, if you go back over here to verse 6, and it said, forsake foolishness. It's the same word. It's the same word. She knows nothing. She's without learning or without wisdom, without the intelligence that comes by surrendering to Jesus and walking with the Spirit. She sits at the door of her house on a seat by the highest places of the city to call to those who pass by, who go straight on their way. Whoever is simple, there's that word again, forsake foolishness, forsake this simplicity, forsake this naivety, forsake that. That would let you be led astray by her, by him. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. Okay, so she's luring you. Now, the Holy Spirit, wisdom, Ema, Mama, invited us to a table, and this family is built on pillars of wisdom and knowledge and understanding and counsel and might and fortitude and strength and righteousness. That's not what she's luring us into. Remember a couple chapter ago we were talking about her, and he said, don't let her allure you with her eyes or bat the... That's what she's doing. I'm delaying here. I'm pausing here because I know what these Hebrew words mean when I get over here. And I don't know if it's... I don't know how to... I guess I'll just tell the truth. That's the way you do it. Whoever's simple, whoever's naive, whoever hasn't forsaken this way that she's trying to lure you in on, let him turn in here. So she's luring. As for him who lacks understanding, who lacks the knowledge of the Holy One, who doesn't know Jesus, she says to him, stolen water is sweet. And bread eaten in secret is pleasant. How tempting is it for you to steal my water? You can get your own, can't you? It's not tempting at all. Why would the devil try to tempt you to steal some bread and water? It's not very, it doesn't take much alluring, does it? It's not what he's talking about. Stolen means it's taken by deception or outside the boundaries of the ways of God that he's established. That's stolen, taken by deception, that you've slid in under the caution tape and taken something that doesn't belong to you, that's not rightfully yours. Water. I looked up the Hebrew word. It can mean water. It can mean urine. It can also mean semen. We're talking about bodily fluids here. Now, we're all adults here, but we know what's all involved in sex, right? Now, sex is alluring. It is tempting. To break the law, to go against the ways of God, to be rebellious and to deny the boundaries that God has set around it. Now, that's tempting. That's what she's inviting us into. There was only twice that I saw in the old King James to where it referred to urine, and that's not the word that the old King James calls it. I was kind of shocked for a minute. It set me back for a minute to realize that the Bible uses that P-I-S-S word, but it does twice. That word was used there. That word is also used to describe when someone has entered into sexual immorality. She's luring us. You don't have to do it that way. Did God really say? Remember back in the Garden of Eden? Did God really say? You won't die. You won't die. Luring. Okay, so stolen bodily fluids is sweet. The word, it means, where is it? The word, it means it is something to be relished by sucking, like fruit, like a strawberry. You know how when you're in the well, in the lap of luxury and in the wealth of all the stuff, and you got servants and they come and they bring you a big fat strawberry. Maybe it's one of those kind like Shelby brings me that are chocolate covered or whatever. And you eat that, and you that's what it's talking about. Sweet like that. It's satisfying. It's pleasure giving. It's pleasant to the senses. Stolen water. And bread, it's a word that means either gender. It can also mean barley or wheat, the fruit of those plants. So stolen water. The fruit, what's the fruit of a woman or the fruit of a man? You put these things together, she's not talking about bread and water here. She's describing it in such a way that's very pleasant and tempting sounding. But she's inviting you to rebel against the ways of God. So it's bread eaten in secret. That means that you take it to a hiding place. Because you're not going to do that just out in front of God and everybody, are you? Not if you have the knowledge of the Holy One, you won't. Hide. Like Adam and Eve in the garden. They tried to cover themselves with the leaves, represent religion. It didn't work, so they hid. That's what we do when we choose sin over righteousness. When we don't value what God has said. One of my greatest regrets is that I did not view marriage from God's viewpoint. I think I cheated myself. Cheated myself of the beauty of what God had in mind for a relationship between a man and a woman. Now God's grace and forgiveness has covered that, and I'm not living in shame and regret and all that. I've been forgiven, and God is restoring life to me and to you and to all of us, and He's making up for these mistakes that we made, and praise God that He does that. But I just sit and wonder sometimes, what would it have been like if I would have done this His way? I think it would have been a lot better. I think I would have avoided a lot of those painful memories, a lot of those regrets that make up this ocean that sometimes I feel like I'm drowning in, of regrets and things of the past. I wish, you know what I'm saying? What if I'd have done it His way? Well, it's available to you now. You know, we start where we are. We start where we are. That's why there's grace. That's why there's forgiveness. That's why there's mercy. We start where we are. And we walk in the way of understanding. And when we walk in the way of the knowledge of the Holy One, in the process of wisdom with the person, Ema, Mama, the supervisor, the teacher, the mama, and develop this intelligent skill to where we're not just about ourselves, but we're about what's beneficial to the body, to the bride of Christ, to the kingdom of God. When we're seeking first His righteousness and His kingdom, and then all these things are added to us, and we're walking in the way, then there's joy and there's peace, and we don't have to worry about the danger of being led astray by her. See, this is default. We will get sucked into the void. You know, for years. Oh, my goodness. For years, I knew the dope was killing me. I knew the dope and the whiskey together were killing me. For years. And I was sick to death of it for a long time. And I would try to quit. I'd get in trouble. I went to drug court. I went to rehab. I went to this. I went to that. I went to prison. I just couldn't. It kept sucking me back in. I tried to do good. I even got out of prison. I had some people recognize the calling and the gifting of God in my life, and they tried to put me to work, but it was religious at best. I wasn't surrendered. I wasn't trying to know Jesus on a personal level. And you know what? You know what happened? Well, you know what happened. I've told this story so many times. It's getting old. I went right back to where I was again. I kept getting sucked back into the vortex, the trap of this whore luring me in. When I entered into a relationship with Jesus, it was like peeling the layers of an onion. All these things, fear, started disappearing. It was replaced with confidence, not confidence in me, confidence in Him. Confidence to sit down at her table and take of the bread and the meat that she set and the wine that she makes that provides joy. Her temptations aren't near as alluring as they used to be. Because I believe. Whoever's simple, she says, let him turn in here. As for him who lacks understanding, the stolen water, the sex outside of the boundaries God said about it is sweet. You're taking something, we're talking about maybe even adultery here. You're taking another man's wife. You're doing all these things. You're doing it in secret. You're doing it in hiding. You're stealing. You're taking something that doesn't belong to you. It's pleasant. It's sweet. It's like sucking on that ripe strawberry. But what this simple guy that took the bait, this is who we're talking about here. Verse 16, we'll finish this. 18, we'll finish this up. But what he, the simple guy, the naive guy, The guy that took the bait, the guy that was lured in, the guy that went in there, what he didn't know, what he does not know, is that the dead are there. The separated from God for eternity. They're there. That's where you're going. She lures you in, that's where you're going. That's where the dead are. That her guests are in the depths of hell. I want you to walk away with this. The invitation is laid out for every living, breathing, walking, socking, soul. Walking, talking, not walking, socking. I sound like a Chinese guy there. Walking, socking. Now, walking, talking, soul that's on the face of this earth, the invitation is laid out here for you. I don't care what your past is. I don't care what's going on in your head. I don't care what's going on in your heart. I don't care if you think you're not eligible for it. I don't care if you think that you've just been too bad a guy. I sang it, the song that I wrote this morning. There's no way this can be. You can't forgive a guy as bad as me. That was what was in my heart when I came here, when he gave me that song. You know what he told me? Just stay. Just stay. You don't have to figure this out in one day. I'm not asking you to be perfect. Just relax and have some faith. I'm taking you in the way, in the day-to-day, in the relationship, in the way of understanding and wisdom. We're going to heaven here, son, and I got you. The invitation is available to each and every one of us. But the Spirit of God won't contend with man forever. There is a day when the curtain on time and history is going to close. And we need to quit messing around here because time is short. Prophecies are converging all over the world. Lawlessness is abounding. Everything that Jesus taught in Mark 13 and Matthew 24 and somewhere over in Luke 6 or something. I don't know where it is, but anyway, we see these things happen. It's ridiculous. The President of the United States is aiding and abetting utter lawlessness. It's time to choose Jesus. Accept the invitation, because if we don't, by default, we're going to be lured into this trap, and without the knowledge of the Holy One, what we don't know is that that's where the dead are. Father, we lift up the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the invitation. Thank you that your divine power has provided everything that we need for life and godliness. Lord, we choose you. We need you, and we want you, and we pray that you'd minister to our hearts. Help us to understand and know the redemption that is ours in Christ Jesus. May this church be blessed with your presence and with your power. Lord, may you be blessed because your kids love you, and we worship you. We desire you. We praise you. Lord, be glorified in our midst. Keep us coming back into this family. Seat us at your table. Bless us with your wisdom and with your understanding. Help us to grow in Jesus, our Savior. We love you, Lord. We thank you. Thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, amen.